VRSA is here to protect our members and their employees so they may effectively serve their communities. What does this mean? Keeping employees and citizens safe, making sure that employees return home to their families in the same condition in which they left, that employees remain safe from hazards and threats, and that citizens can safely utilize member-owned facilities, parks, recreation areas, sidewalks, and more. VRSA offers a variety of resources and specialists to assist members in working to strengthen their risk management program. One advocate for VRSA's risk services team is risk manager for the town of Herndon, Roxann Fox Simkins.
The risk manager position was established a few years ago because we were approaching safety and risk in a very disjointed way. And it really didn't send the appropriate message to the staff, to the council, to the citizens of this town. We had to go about trying to bring in a risk professional to then coalesce those efforts so that we truly put our money where our mouth is in terms of safety.
So being the first risk manager for the town of Herndon has provided me with the opportunity to really highlight the issues for the town in a holistic way. Now, the Department of Public Works had someone who was dedicated to safety and safety operations, but they were siloed within that department. So I get the opportunity to come in and tap the microphone and begin speaking about risk management and safety for all to hear.
One way Simkins is working to strengthen the town's focus on risk management is by utilizing several of VRSA's services, including VRSA's mock OSHA inspection, to help strengthen the town's risk management programs.
As folks who work for the town, we are entrusted with the care of the town, and that includes the people who are in it just visiting, the people who live here, and the people who work here. So safe facilities, safe parks, safe playgrounds, safe streets, safe trails, it's, again, just a no-brainer. I think that we also have to acknowledge that there's a price tag that goes along with keeping our facilities and our parks and our town in tip-top shape and in a safe condition. If our town isn't in a safe condition and people get hurt, there's negligence associated, there's claims that have to be paid. Fixing a piece of sidewalk today is a lot cheaper than fixing an entire block of sidewalk 3 months from now after someone has fallen. And you may even want to acknowledge that it's the reputation of your town. We don't want to be on the news as, you know, child falls in the town of Herndon. We want to be on the news ranking as, you know, top 10 towns in the country. And a focus on risk management and safety can hopefully get us there.
Throughout the video, you will hear about inspecting to prevent or reduce slips, trips, and falls. That's because slips, trips, and falls are the number one cost driver for workers' compensation claims, with this type of loss accounting for the greatest costs over the last 5 years. In fact, slips, trips, and falls resulted in more than $19 million in workers' compensation costs over the last 5 years and nearly $3 million in liability costs. In the spring of 2021, Simkins approached town manager Bill Ashton with the idea to invite VRSA out to conduct a mock VOSH inspection.
Our town manager, like I said before, was jazzed when we brought this up. So was our director of public works. I think that they saw that it was something that was needed, and only good things could come on the tail end of flushing out the potential issues. I can totally understand why some folks might be nervous to contact their insurer and say, hey, can you come help me find the skeletons in my closet? But we all know that VRSA is not a typical insurer. VRSA is in it with us like a partnership.
You know, we got a different set of eyes on things, and you know, you get blind to some of the things that are out there. You just walk by it every day and you forget that it's there and it's a problem. So it allowed us to identify a lot of both big and little problems and then work down that list until they were corrected. Having kind of an independent third person who doesn't walk the building every day go through and take a look at these things and say, well, what about that? And why is this way? And, you know, identify safety issues that way.
Simkins looked at the mock inspection as a learning opportunity.
And as we walked through with our safety consultant, something magical began to happen. It was almost as if I was immersed into an OSHA 10 class, but it was a hands-on class, because at every single turn, I was being taught in a hands-on way about, look at this over here, and what do you think about this, and could this code match that? And so the education that's provided as you just walk through the day is unlike anything that you could experience anywhere else. So with that education came then the ability to turn around and not only follow up on what the issues that were found were, but to be able to articulate those issues to the folks that were going to be the risk owners, that were going to be responsible for the fixes. What it also did is, on the tail end, now we're able to conduct our own inspections because we know how to walk through the room and do an inspection in the VRSA way.
Since the initial mock inspection with VRSA, Simkins and Herndon Operations Manager Christine Mason have begun conducting their own inspections throughout the town. The town also created a formal safety committee, nicknamed the Risk Rangers, to address the results of the inspection and identify safety hazards and needs as they arise.
We formed almost like the Care Bear Stare, where we all have different specialties, and we really did come together to figure out how are we going to tackle this, because it's definitely not a task that can be accomplished alone. You're going to need a collective group of people who are just as dedicated as you are to resolving the issues.
Care Bears, stare!
Hey, Risk Rangers, thank you for coming again. Let's jump in and let's talk about what's on the agenda for today. Randy.
One of the things we have in the works right now, the golf course had some damage to the roof through hail and drainage, but they have some structural problems with the framing. So I've got a structural engineer coming out to do an evaluation to make sure it's safe before we redo the roof out there. So that's something that's in the works.
So the structural damage, is this a long-term wear and tear issue, or is this something that could have been generated from a loss and we could potentially file a claim with VRSA for this? Is this insurable?
If my interpretation, at least right now, is that it has to do with an aging structure. We've got some trusses that are starting to rot out and some supports that are starting to pull away from the building, but I believe it's probably just an age-related issue.
Tammy, you were going to give me an update on the racking system that's out in the sheds.
Sheds.
Has that seen any forward movement?
A little bit. We're working on kind of the logistics of it, moving one thing, moving another, but I think we're focusing on our generator room.
VRSA safety consultant Christine Gillison recently visited the town of Herndon to conduct another mock inspection alongside Simkins and Mason, something Simkins plans on requesting biannually. The trio headed to the Herndon Centennial Golf Course to inspect several facilities, including the on-site shop.
Most inspectors have their own routines in order to do their best to capture as many things as they can within a space like this. When you're in a shop, there's lots of things to look at. So what I like to do is go through and, starting on my left, working around the room to my right. And then as I'm walking from the left to the right, I am also looking up and I'm looking down. And mentally, there's a lot going on, right? You're thinking, as a safety person, you are thinking of the electrical, you're thinking of slips, trips, and falls, you're thinking of For example, fire extinguishers, are they mounted? Are they in good condition? For example, fan blades. You want to make sure that the fan blade guards are no more than half an inch so that you can't put your fingers in. Also, you're going to look for external doors and internal doors. Are they blocked? Is there, is it an exit? We're looking for exit signs, tools and equipment. Over here, you're making sure that there are guards. If they're not in use, they're unplugged or in a safe position. Okay, so when was the last time the lift was inspected?
We actually had the lift inspected last year in 2022, that was in June. They came out to do our annual inspection on all of our lifts that we have townwide, this being the one at the golf shop.
As the trio continued their inspection, they found many areas that had been noted in the previous inspection.
Oh, no way. This is awesome. This was packed full of stuff.
Definitely in the electrical closets or rooms, you want to make sure that the rooms are locked, which they were. And there is no material. It's not to be used as storage room. And all of the panel boxes are open and accessible. So this is excellent.
Okay, so when we're taking a look at the fueling station here, we have our secondary containment here. It will catch our grasses off our carts and our lawn mowers, but it'll also catch our fuel spill off. If we have any fuel spills, it'll catch in our secondary containment and run to a filter system. But as we're looking at here, you want to make sure that you're looking for trip hazards to make sure your grates are down, to make sure there's nothing that your foot can go through. In the past, we've had a place where the grate separated a little bit, so you have to come in and maintain and get your welders out there to fix it. So that you make sure that as you're going, there are no trips that you can follow. Okay, so as a result of our last inspection, we found that our ballards for the protection of our fuel tanks were not spaced properly. And in order to protect our fuel tanks from somebody running into them and causing an accident or an explosion, our quick, inexpensive, but effective way to fix this was to bring a jersey wall and put it outside here. Well, they can still use the fuel tanks. We make sure they're protected.
When you walk into a building that you feel sometimes might not need inspections, you want to make sure you do those and keep those on a regular inspection because things can happen. So the electrical could be an issue, especially buildings that aren't looked at or even visited on a regular basis. The electrical could deteriorate, the conduit could rust, water could get into the conduit. But so it's super important to have those inspections periodically.
On the ride back to the clubhouse area, Simkins and Gillison kept an eye on the path areas and fencing.
It might look like we're just having fun and games and out for a good time, but what we're really doing is seeing how this cart path operates. So many people drive these golf carts and walk on these paths every single day. And so we want to make sure that our patrons and our staff are safe and they avoid the slips, trips, falls, and unnecessary accidents.
Which is a good thing because that is our number one claim is for slips, trips, and falls accidents.
Ah. So the trees right here serve as the protection,
right,
so to speak, your liability protection from the homes over there.
Yeah.
So.
Yes, and I noticed there's lots of thorn and spiky bushes, which is also recommended when protecting barriers with shrubbery.
Okay, here we have our chemicals in a secondary containment area so that we're keeping them up off the floor in case of a leakage. We have a secondary containment to catch them. Here we have our confined space. We have it properly labeled. Good job! High five! Here we have a chemical room. We have our correct placards up here. We have our safety gear that we need to go into the room. So this is a good job.
Yeah.
Awesome. Same thing here.
So when you talk about a culture of risk management or a safety culture, this right here is an example of how we know that culture is being solidified within the town. When we do an inspection and then return a week later and so many of the things that have been discussed have already been rectified without any follow-up, it really lets you know that folks are taking this seriously and that folks care. I mean, look at the label on the bucket. That bucket is bringing me such joy right now. And it's not the label that's on the bucket that brings me the joy. The label lets me know that the mentality of the people who work in this area is shifting. They have bought into the culture of safety.
This is an eyewash station that you're required to have when you have chemicals on site. Eyewash stations are required to be tested weekly. So in here are the chemicals put into secondary containment. Secondary containers need to be labeled as to what they are and their hazards, along with warning and precaution statements, along with their GHS pictograms. Some of these are labeled, but they don't have the proper labeling on them, so we'll go ahead and address those back.
So keep in mind that in places like your community centers, you're really gonna wanna keep your eye on what the situation is with the floor. Remember, slips, trips, and falls, not only for your employees, but in areas where there's going to be frequent foot traffic. So in places like your gym and your fitness room, check these mats out. Make sure that they're gonna be sturdy for your feet and you're not gonna have any trip issues. Check out your floors and your flooring panels and make sure everything is safe for the folks that you've got involved.
Maintaining areas where slips, trips, and falls may take place is crucial in protecting your employees, your citizens who may utilize these areas, and your entity's reputation. By preventing or reducing slips, trips, and falls, you will be able to keep more employees on the job, reduce injuries to citizens, and keep these incidents out of the local headlines.
So exciting. So there was a sewage leak from the bathroom into here, and yeah. It caused a bunch of the stuff that was being stored in here to have to be disposed of, hence the beautiful condition you see
wonderful.
Today.
Wonderful. Awesome.
Simkins says part of building a risk management culture is identifying the current culture and learning why people do what they do.
You've got to get curious about why people are doing what they're doing. So let's just use an example of, let's say, refuse crews wearing hard hats out in the street. Now, maybe you get a new employee and that new employee isn't wearing that hard hat, and you can reprimand them and you can tell them what the rules are, but they already know that. They were told those rules on day one, but they're choosing not to execute that rule. So why is it? You'll never know if you don't talk to them. And then when you get down and you start talking to them, what you find out is every time they bend over, this hard hat falls off. Or they previously worked for a different, maybe, municipality, and wearing hard hats wasn't a requirement for the refuse crew. So then what you're able to explain at that point is you're able to explain that it's more stringent than the industry standard, and that's what we've chosen to do. And maybe you're able to get a hard hat with a chin strap. So you're able to speak directly to that person's why. And when you speak to the why, what you're doing is you're motivating them, you're changing their mindset, which then kicks off a different belief system, and it's that belief system that's going to drive the behavior that they take. And I've noticed that these things are happening. People will come up to you and people will say, hey, have you seen that over there? And so that's how you know that all the work is beginning to cement, because you'll have individuals who just pop out of the woodwork, maybe like little meerkats. Here they go, and here they go. And then they're mirroring back those risk and safety issues to you. Another example, I just spoke with a supervisor, someone in leadership in DPW the other day, and he mentioned to me that we're about to have our summer concert series. So he was gonna get out there and take a look at the sidewalks, make sure that there weren't any issues that needed to be addressed before we had a lot of heavy foot traffic in the spring. Now, I don't know if this man has always done his job like that, but I know that he thought enough to say it out loud and to tell that to me. So it lets me know that we're like-minded in keeping the folks of town safe. So the parks get inspected. We have somebody who's a certified park inspector in DPW.
And so playground as well?
It is a
playground inspector.
There we
okay.
go. Got you.
Okay. As you can see, we have AstroTurf fields here. Our grounds department goes through every other year training on AstroTurf maintenance. and repair so that they can keep these free of hazards for our citizens and our community group to play here. They would be looking for rips, divots. You also want to make sure that there are no rocks, no mulch, sticks from trees out here, so that you have to make sure there's no trip hazards out here. As we go down through the sidewalks, take a look around, make sure you're looking for trip hazards, make sure you're looking for anything that's loose. If you can see anything that might be a trip hazard or a fall hazard, as you're coming out of a business, this area in particular has coffee and food. So if somebody has dropped something, you want to make sure that we're taking a look for the slips and making sure that everything gets cleaned up.
So you want to also look for the loose bolts over time, and with the weather and the freeze and thaw, bolts and other things, as far as the bricks are also concerned, can stick up as well.
VRSA safety consultants will often provide advice for areas that are not currently hazards but could become hazards in the future.
So do you see how the hump is?
Yes.
I think what's happening here is the travel inside and the path is getting worn down. So over time, you can see the lip sticking up a little bit. In the next 4 to 5 years, you can plan this in the budget for it to be repaired. It's not something that's really an issue at this point in time, but obviously you can see where the traffic flow is, and it's going to continue to be pounded down and other bricks are going to pop up.
Okay, so in our last inspection that we had with VRSA, we noticed that these grates were degraded and rusting, and they became a fall hazard for anybody who might be walking through here. So we had a project to get all the grates around Town Hall replaced.
Oh wait, hold on, there's a trip hazard here, a missing brick. So we'll put that down on the list.
Absolutely, let me get a picture of it.
Take a picture of that.
So that we can get it into our work order system.
Wonderful.
The group discussed how risk management and hazard inspections is not a one-time process, that risks evolve and change seasonally, and efforts to mitigate hazards must be continuous.
For your information, there's a lot more to ogres than people think.
Example?
Example? Okay, ogres are like onions.
They stink?
Yes. No.
Oh, they make you cry?
No.
Oh, you leave them out in the sun, they get all brown, start sprouting little white hairs?
No. Layers. Onions have layers. Ogres have layers. Onions.
It's like an onion.
Exactly. And we're just constantly peeling it back.
Layers. It's layers.
And I think that's how you do it. You can say, okay, you know, in your first inspection, we looked at this and we peeled that layer back and we got that cleared out. Then the next inspection, we're going to come out with another set of eyes and we're going to come back and look at it again.
Right.
So that we can say, you know, okay, this is great and you did fabulous here. Now let's just move on to the next thing. You know, we've checked that box and now we're going to go down the list.
And that's, I think that's where we're at right now in terms of, for the purposes of this inspection, right?
Absolutely. Because you're never going to get right the first time. You're never going to get everything accomplished the first time. That's why you want to inspect annually.
Correct.
You want to bring in your experts. You want to bring in VRSA to help us see what we don't see, because we see it every day. We want to be able to make this a progress and a checklist that we're constantly going back. Just because you write a policy doesn't mean it doesn't need to be reviewed. You have to review this and you have to do it. If you set it up on a schedule, if you set it up that I did the inspection in March. Every March, we're going to come out and do this, and then we're going to look at it every year as a whole.
Yeah.
You're going to come out every other year to help us. But in the meantime, that's when your quarterly safety inspections on your checklist should come in from the people who are in the space.
Yeah.
So if they're doing their quarterly inspections, we come in yearly, you come in every other year.
I also encourage people, when they have safety committees, that they bring on employees, just the worker employees, so that they have an opportunity to do inspections of other locations. So you're getting a fresh set of eyes within your facility, not even having to reach out to VRSA to do that. But
you might focus on eyewash station. You know, Roxann might focus on fire extinguishers. Mm-hmm. I might focus on secondary containers. We all have our specialties.
Yes, absolutely.
So if you bring that all together, then we're all looking at multiple things. And then the more people you bring in, the more safety conscious they are. And they're willing to point it out to their coworkers, their supervisors, and to us so that we can all make it a cohesive program so that we keep everybody safe.
The group focused on how security measures around the facility are also crucial to protecting their employees and citizens.
Okay, so we have just installed a new security pedestrian gate and drive-through gate. Originally, our gate was this entire width right here, and it was open, free swinging, and people could come and go. We have a call box where employees of the town of Herndon would use their badge and swipe it, or if you were coming to visit, you would park in our visitor parking, and you would hit this button, and somebody inside would ask your purpose, and then if you were granted access, it would buzz, and you would be able to push in. We do have a fence all the way around our property. With the upgrade with our security on our pedestrian gate, and with the upgrade down at our drive-through gate, we can better control the flow of traffic in and out. I personally walk the perimeter once a quarter.
Awesome.
But all of our guys will also walk the perimeter throughout their days so that they can look for anything that might be, you know, a hydraulic leak or something they can look for. After hours, we have to badge in, again, for a security measure. This is where our original inspection found difficulties with our racking systems.
Right.
We didn't know what the load ratings were. They weren't mounted to the walls and didn't have the proper shelving on them. So we pulled them down and we're in the process of getting funding so that we can put new and improved, correct racking systems up to get our supplies up off the ground and give us more floor space for our equipment.
I just want to make sure that when you guys do actually purchase them, that you are looking at the items you're going to be storing. Since you already know that you're going to put these on there, do you intend on putting the whole pallet on there, or are you going to piece them off of the pallet and put them on the shelves? And the reason for that is because the load ratings, right? If you have the manifest for a pallet, get the size or the weight, and that way you can determine your average weight of pallets that you were going to be storing, so to make sure that you're getting the correct shelving units. I like that there is a clear path going in here. Now, because these items are filled with fuel, the proper ventilation, obviously right now it's the winter months and nobody's running them, but you want to make sure that they're not being run with employees in here.
So I heard you before when you were explaining the grid search method, how when you walk into a room, how you go about assessing that room. But when you're out in an open area like this, I mean, where do you even start?
Well, it's the same concept, right? We're looking down at the ground. We're looking at the buildings themselves. Any doors that you're not sure of, those are always the good places to go looking, because behind closed doors, you know, people tend to shove things and put things where they don't normally or are not supposed to go. General housekeeping for your vehicles. So if you run over a piece of wood with a nail in it, then you've got a flat tire. When we're inspecting outside, you want to look for sample pedestrian walkways. So as she is walking around the corner, there is a potential for people to be coming from the other side and them not seeing her. So best practice adding pedestrian pathways like taping or painting. And you ask your employees that, okay, if you're in the yard and you're on foot, then you need to stay within the
pathways.
Pedestrian pathways,
right,
to prevent those potential vehicle incidents.
Okay, so this is a trash compactor, and while it seems very innocuous, it's actually a very dangerous piece of equipment. When we first put in the compactor, this was open. This was just a wide open area. So the fencing went in, so that we can have fall protection for our employees. If you see the little cutout piece at the top, that's so they can reach the controls, because the controls are actually made on the side of it. So they don't have to lean over, they don't have to do anything. They're protected from a fall, but yet still able to operate the machinery. And on the other side in front of is also a fence so that it's closed when not in use.
Welcome to Kevin Cooks Stuff in the Office. I am your host, Kevin.
Okay, now in the kitchen, we're going to be looking at our outlets. We're going to be looking at what's plugged in, how it's plugged in.
I'd like to commend you guys, because a lot of times what will happen in kitchen areas like this, they'll have extension cords and power strips, and they'll have all of this equipment on the power strips. And you guys have taken the time to add extra receptacles so that it wouldn't overload those power strips and it wouldn't encourage employees to do daisy chaining. You know, we'd be looking for trip hazards and any kind of electrical, open electrical.
No, we're good.
Missing cover plates, if there are broken receptacles.
A thorough inspection will also include areas such as outdoor parks and recreation areas.
So even your parks need to get a fresh set of eyes on them. So we're out here in Runnymede Park. So it's a historical site, and we're going to have a lot of extra foot traffic around here. So I want to take a look at the site and see what you have to say about it.
Even terrain, there's no holes or dips for people to trip and fall in. Security even. You want to walk around these areas to ensure there hasn't been any vandalism or any activity, which would then alert you to potential issues.
The venting, which potentially bees, snakes, vermin, spiders, anything.
Even though the structures are fairly new, like within 5 years or so, you want to make sure that they still stay in rotation as far as an inspection. Even though the first 5 or even 10 years, they're going to be in good condition, try not to neglect them in your inspection.
So just making sure that even the new equipment gets in, or the new structures get in the cycle of inspection, is going to solidify that sustainability.
Throughout the day, the group discussed how seasonal changes can impact the type of inspections that should be done.
If there's one thing I can say about risk management, is it's not boring. There's always something. And so one of the things to keep in mind is seasonal changes. If you haven't been able to tell, today is a windy day. So after a windy day, maybe we should take a look at the status of our parks. What happened with our trees in town? When the seasons warm up, we've got a concert series coming, which is going to bring a lot of extra foot traffic. So come early spring, before that foot traffic starts happening, we want to take a look at things and make sure that the winter hasn't eroded anything. We've also got lots of parks and playgrounds. So springtime, kids are really getting out there. And then also keep in mind that at the end of summer, maybe your equipment has taken a beating through the course of the summer. So there's always a seasonal rotation, so to speak, of the things that you're looking at.
After the mock inspection, VRSA safety consultants will provide the member with a series of reports, including codes and suggestions for abatement.
So what we got was a spreadsheet that encapsulated everything methodically, line by line. It had codes, it had a risk owner column, it had follow-up dates, so that you were able to go out there and then take care of everything and then have the tracking system already at your fingertips. The other piece of documentation that was provided to us that had photos, this became critical, because as we're walking through, back through each facility and explaining to the risk owner, we're able to show them visual documentation of what was found.
When applicable, VRSA staff may suggest the member apply for risk management grants to address hazards.
So on the tail end of the inspection, the only thing VRSA did was check in on us and make sure that we had the tools and resources needed so that we could accomplish the task at hand. You know, one of the questions that they asked us was if we needed any financial assistance, and they reminded us about the safety grant, the risk management safety grant that comes once a year.
The contents of the report are kept confidential.
As you know, we don't share this information. It's just between you and I. It doesn't even go to my supervisor.
Many changes have been made since the initial inspection provided by VRSA, and additional changes and abatements are being made each day.
Part of making sure that these efforts are sustainable is making sure that that culture is cemented and making sure that those around you understand why you're doing what you're doing. That it's not just a spreadsheet, but here is what the spreadsheet represents. Like I mentioned earlier with the gentleman who told me when he was going to do his inspections, it was something that was already on my mind. So there's the sustainability. When you have a procurement officer stopping people at the gate, questioning insurance requirements, there's the sustainability. When you have people in facilities supervision pointing things out and raising flags, asking you questions, there is the sustainability. So without developing that culture of people who care and people who get it, a piece of paper or a policy or a procedure isn't going to create a sustainable environment. It's the people that are going to create that sustainable environment.
Simkins stresses that creating a risk management culture requires support from top management.
Nothing would happen without that top-down support and creating that culture of accountability and that culture of having risk-minded individuals.
It comes down to every single worker. They all have to be aware of it. But I think a big key is the supervisors, crew leaders, because they're out there with the two or three or four other people. So making sure that those folks do their job in a safe way, I think, is really important, particularly in DPW, where there are a lot of jobs that are high risk. Want everybody to go home in the same condition that they came. Risk management also has to deal with property damage, so parts of risk management are making sure that we take on things before they become bigger, mitigate things so that they don't become personnel hazards, both for the staff and for the general public.
I truly enjoy that sharing my knowledge, but it's not just about me, it's more about VRSA and how we want to help our members. It's, like you said earlier, it's not a gotcha. It is raising you guys up.
And when you go through the process of removing risks, repairing things that might cause a safety concern, when you take these things out of the equation, just because you've taken them out of the equation, you have created a safer environment. So we're not going to know how many people didn't trip and fall on that rickety piece of brick that was repaired. And that's great. I don't want to know how many people are going to trip and fall. That's why we fixed it, because the possibility was there. You address the risks at hand. Your town and your municipality, your location will just be safer because of that.
I think VRSA's role in our safety culture is invaluable. They bring training to bear, they instruct us, they help and guide us. They are an enormous resource to our risk manager in trying to establish that environment and that culture that we're talking about. They truly were a thought leader in this area in helping us establish that risk manager position and truly have helped usher us and guide us to a better culture in terms of safety.
No one comes to work wanting to become injured. Site inspections help prevent incidents before they happen. To get started with site inspections, contact your risk services representative today. They can get you started with sample inspection forms or come to your site to perform a complimentary inspection.